This is a tape recording of radio transmission from the Russian satellite with a discussion of its interpretation. On October 4th, Russia launched an Earth satellite and immediately reported to the world its approximate orbit and the frequencies of its radio signals. The next day, members of the Electrical Engineering Department at Caltech decided to listen for its signals, solely out of curiosity. Excellent signals were received at a frequency of about 20 megacycles on two successive passes in the evening of that day. According to the early information from Russia, the satellite was to be transmitting at two frequencies, 20.005 and 40.002 megacycles. After the second day, signals were received at Caltech on both frequencies. For the first 3 days, both signals were beeping. That is, the carrier was alternately switched on and off, and it appeared that when one channel was on, the other was off. For the 20 megacycle signal, the on period was measured on October 5th to be about 0.21 seconds, and the off period about the same. The next day, a similar record showed an on time of about 0.16 seconds and an off time of about 0.23 seconds. As far as possible telemetering is concerned, conclusions drawn from these data are left to the listener. It is our personal opinion that these signals contain no telemetering, or at most a low accuracy telemetering of simple information, and that the beeping was primarily for purposes of easy identification. Here is a sample of the signal received on the 20 megacycle channel on the evening of October the 7th. No doubt you noticed systematic variation in the amplitude of the received signal. This could have been amplitude modulation telemetering. But such an effect would also result from rolling or tumbling of the satellite due to its non-isotropic antenna pattern, or from ionosphere variations. It is unlikely that such a telemetering method would have been attempted. On the 9 p.m. pass of October 7th, it was observed that the 20 megacycle signal was no longer beeping, but was CW. The 40 megacycle signal was still beeping. On this same day, at the 10:45 p.m. pass, the 20 megacycle signal was heard to change from CW to beeping. By the following day, both channels were transmitting CW signals, and they remained CW for the lifetime of the power supply, except for a few sporadic attempts to beep, each of which would last for only a few seconds. Here is a sample from the record of 7 a.m. on October the 14th. Note the change of tone that accompanies the onset and cessation of beeping. There will be comments made about this later.
October 6th, it was decided to attempt Doppler measurements, and a DC-221 frequency standard was obtained. The evening of October 7th, the first Doppler measurements were made, and showed that the satellite passed nearest to Pasadena at about 10:48 p.m. and at a distance of about 600 miles. By October 8th, the group at Caltech had made the decision to attempt a series of accurate Doppler measurements. The experimental setup was to use a receiver set for reception of an AM signal. The input consisted of the satellite signal plus a signal from a local standard oscillator set about 1 kilocycle below the satellite frequency. In the detection process, a signal is produced whose frequency is the difference between the observed satellite frequency and the frequency of the standard. Since the satellite has a velocity relative to the observer, the apparent satellite frequency will differ from the actual frequency by an amount proportional to the normal component of the relative velocity. In other words, a Doppler shift will result due to the relative velocity. Since the velocity of a low-altitude satellite is about 5 miles per second, the total Doppler shift for a 20 megacycle signal should be about 1 kilocycle, and for a 40 megacycle signal, about 2 kilocycles. Such a change would be very noticeable to a listener. Such measurements require high stability of the satellite transmitter and the local standards. There is obviously no control over the satellite frequency, but the evidence indicates a high degree of stability. The local standards used were a BC221 for the 20.005 megacycle channel and a Gertsch FM3 for the 40.002 megacycle channel. Here is a sample of the 40 megacycle signal received from Sputnik as it passed nearly overhead at 9 p.m. on October 10th. When you first hear the signal, the satellite is about 300 miles south-southwest out over the Pacific Ocean. At its closest approach, it was about 140 miles above and perhaps 20 miles east of Pasadena. Thank you. The interference heard in the middle of the record is the local smog control on a frequency close to 40 megacycles. In addition, one can identify automobile traffic on California Street at several times. When the satellite is further away, the Doppler shift occurs more slowly, as evidenced by the following record taken at 3:15 a.m. on October 23rd. On this path, the satellite was about 400 miles from Pasadena at time of nearest approach. The variation in amplitude on this record is a particularly good example of the periodic amplitude modulation mentioned earlier. Also, at the end of this record, there is an interesting momentary variation in pitch, which resembles the pulling of the carrier frequency that occurred on an earlier record when Sputnik was sporadically trying to beep. One might ask how much information can be obtained from Doppler records of this sort. For example, a single Doppler record has a point of symmetry, which determines the time of nearest approach, a total frequency shift, which determines the relative velocity, and a characteristic shape, which gives the slant distance of nearest approach. Unfortunately, drifts in the oscillator frequency, poor distant reception, interference, the effect of a curved Earth in orbit, as well as possible ionosphere uncertainties, make the deductions from a single record of limited accuracy, except for the time of nearest approach, which can usually be obtained within 1 or 2 seconds if the satellite passes closer than 800 miles from the observer. By taking a series of Doppler records, more accurate information can be obtained. For example, we feel that we have measured the changing period of the satellite over a 2-week interval with an accuracy of better than 1 part in 20,000. In addition, it has been possible to determine approximately the altitude of the satellite orbit over Pasadena, the approximate eccentricity of the elliptical orbit, the inclination of the orbit with respect to the equatorial plane, and the rate of precession of the orbit about the polar axis. We find that the altitude of the evening pass, which is approximately perigee, is about 140 miles. The eccentricity is such that the altitude at apogee is about 600 miles. The orbital inclination is 65 degrees, and the rate of precession is 3.2 degrees per day. On October 11th at 9 a.m., the period was 5,757.4 seconds, and the period was observed to decrease at the nearly constant rate of 0.16 seconds each rotation. It is not appropriate in a discussion of this length to consider the probable errors of these results or to discuss corrections for the curved Earth trajectory. This work was carried out largely by the following people: Hardy Martell, Charles Wilt, Bill Pilkington, Pete Mason, Al Treblepiece, Dwayne Irway, and John Emmett, all of whom are staff members or students of the California Institute of Technology. This is the end of the recording.